طيب مساء الخير. As you know, we have been done yesterday with the use of insulin in the treatment of diabetes mellitus, and we explained the indications and the several types and how to deal with each of them and the differences that you might encounter both pharmacologically and clinically. Now, to wrap up the topic of the treatment of diabetes, we have to discuss the oral and injectable anti-diabetic agents. And the first thing to mention here is that these drugs were used to be called oral hypoglycemic agents. And this term is not used anymore because of two things. The first thing is that they're not only used orally, some of them can be injectable. And the other thing, as you will find during this lecture, and actually half of them do not cause hypoglycemia. They are not complicated by hypoglycemia. And that's why we cannot call them as a class as hypoglycemic agents. Just to give you a diagram that might be used later on during the explanation of the mechanism of action of these drugs, our target is to deal with this hyperglycemia and to reduce it, the glucose levels in the blood. We have several factors and sources for this increased level of glucose, and we have to act on all of them actually, including the level of absorption from the intestine, including the level of secretion of both insulin and glucagon and how they deal with hyperglycemia. In addition to that, the other sources of glucose production endogenously, so one cannot gluconeogenesis in the liver, how can it in muscular glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis. In addition to that, we have to also talk about the fat metabolism and how the levels of glucose are related to what type of fat metabolism happens in the body. And finally, which is also very important, is the role of your brain, in the control of such factors. Do I have to eat more? Do I have to eat less? And how the appetite and satiety centers are affected. And let's not forget also the levels of glucose that are excreted in the kidney after passing the glucose threshold. Tamam? Our renal threshold for the excretion of glucose. So, to start with, I'm going to start with the most commonly used class of oral antidiabetic agents, and these are the biguanides. And indeed, you have to know what the clinical particulars about this class, because as you will see, lots of type 2 diabetic patients are using this class of drugs. Now, in general, the mechanism of action of this class is not very well understood. ولكن على الأقل we know a few things that might be true about them. The first thing is that they target the peripheral insulin sensitivity. So they increase the sensitivity of your peripheral tissues to insulin. يعني بمعنى آخر, they activate the GLUT receptors to be responsive more to the insulin, and so they can uptake glucose from the plasma into the insulin. تمام? Which is important. So they are considered peripheral insulin sensitizers. The other thing is that they also work on the endogenous production of glucose in the body, particularly the hepatic gluconeogenesis, and they reduce it to a significant level. And finally, they also act to decrease glucose absorption. Now, is that the major mechanism of action of them and why they are used commonly? Indeed, no. This is part of the truth. Now, the other thing is that over a long period of time, 4 to 6 weeks, and you have to have this period, otherwise you're not going to achieve such effect, they might have a very positive effect on fat metabolism. Let's not forget, type 2 diabetics are obese, and with their obesity, there is bad fat metabolism and increased insulin resistance. If you act on the long run, on the fat metabolism to reduce the bad lipoproteins and to increase the good lipoproteins, this is going to be beneficial. وعشان هيك المفروض رح تشوفوا بالcommunity this drug is extremely it's commonly used, اللي هو المتفورمين أو الجلوكوفاج حتى للناس اللي ما عندهمش diabetes. ليش بيستخدموه؟ To lose weight. لأن whether that is related to the positive effect on fat metabolism or any other mechanism, it's a fact. It's an off-label indication of metformin to lose weight. Then some important things about it. You know, this is an oral insulin sensitizer. It does not act on the insulin secretion. يعني إذا قسنا level of insulin after the use of metformin, it's not going to be increased or decreased. No, there's no change. لأن نتيجة لأنهم they don't act on the insulin secretion, they're actually not complicated by hypoglycemia, which is important. عشان هيك حنسميهم euglycemic agents. تمام؟ They don't induce a state of hypoglycemia. لأن وبسبب ال positive effects on the fat metabolism, they are actually complicated أو حتى خلينا نحكي one of the good total effects of this drug إنه to lose weight أو على الأقل إنه not to gain any more weight. And that might improve the peripheral insulin sensitivity in such diabetic patients. لأن ال actual thing إنه lots of people who use this metformin or glucophage, أول إشي بصير معهم severe GI disturbances that are intolerable. يعني بصير عنده severe nausea, severe vomiting, severe gastric discomfort. بكرهك وبكره الساعة اللي أعطته فيها الدواء. ولذلك أصلاً كل التكس أو كثير من التكس بوكس يعتقدوا بأنه السبب بأنه الست بتخسر وزن. يعني ليش بيستخدموه لخسارة الوزن؟ مش لأنه بيشتغل على الفات ميتابوليزم. وإنما لأنه إيش؟ بكرههم بالفود. So their appetite is decreased, their food intake is decreased. تمام؟ So there is severe type of GI disturbance. ولذلك, any diabetic patient who wants to use metformin, they have to be advised إنه to take the drug with the food, not on empty stomach. And the other thing is to expect إنه these side effects will fade away after a while. يعني they will get used to it. لكن مش شرط إنه كل مرضى يستحمل. كثير من المرضى بيقولك لا, أوكي أنا ما بقدرش. I cannot tolerate it anymore. And we have to switch them into another class. هلا بنحكي عنه. The other thing which is not particularly common, ولكنها if it happened, and it's going to be very severe and life-threatening, is the risk of lactic acidosis. Well, acidosis in your body or in the patient's body is a life-threatening emergency that might end up with mortality. Now, in particular, patients who are aged above 80, elderly patients, هذول في الغالب الorgan systems عندهم يعني بلشت الfunction declining. فبمجرد ما تعرضوا ل something like metformin, they have a high risk of lactic acidosis, and that's why it's actually contraindicated to be used in diabetic patients above 80 years of age. The other thing, again, in lactic acidosis happens mostly if there can be end organ failure, like in the cases of kidney failure, heart failure, or liver failure. But let's not forget that the مشكلة بأنه diabetics have high risk of nephropathy. تل عندهم end organ failure, وبالتالي بدك تعطيهم metformin, for it does not work. It's contraindicated to be used in such cases. In general, this is your first line oral antidiabetic agent in any newly diagnosed type 2 diabetic patient, وخاصة إذا كان obese patient. وإحنا عارفين type 2 diabetics, the majority of them are obese, and that's why this is considered your first line anti-diabetic agent after the diagnosis. والأمر الثاني بأنه it's integral to combination. السؤال أنه can I use it with insulin at the same time, يعني أعطي للمريض insulin plus metformin? Of course yes, I can. ليش؟ لأنه this drug actually increases insulin sensitivity, وبالتالي it's advisable to use metformin and insulin at the same time in some patients. مش كل patients. Okay. الآن في حال إنه المريض is not responding well to metformin, أو إنه المريض is not tolerating the side effects of metformin very well, we might need to use the other class of drugs that have most likely a very similar mechanism of action, and these are called the thiazolidinediones or TCDs, يعني as abbreviated. Now, the mechanism of action is not very well known, ولكن what we know, in fact, that they are targeting a transcription factor inside certain cells in the body, having a transcription factor is called PPAR gamma. Then once they target it and activate it, المهم النت ريزلت. In net result, they will go and function the same as metformin, in particular inhibiting hepatic gluconeogenesis and increasing the sensitivity of the muscle to insulin. On top of that, which is the most important mechanism, is actually their function on the fat metabolism, and again, inhibition of adipogenesis and increasing the good lipoproteins like HDL. لان بهذه الأسباب إنه يعتبر الثيازيلدين دايونز as oral insulin sensitizer. The same applies to metformin. They don't have any risk of hypoglycemia. تمام؟ وإن in fact they will induce some sort of يعني إذا ما كانش في a net stabilization of body weight, they might lead to increase body weight a little bit, not too much. تمام؟ لا مشكلتهم بأنهم they have hepatic metabolism and they induce a state of fluid retention and edema. وهذا يؤدي لأنه they are contraindicated أو على الأقل they have to be stopped إذا كان patient عنده chronic heart failure أو حتى عنده chronic renal failure. هاي fluid retention and edema might be risky on them لأنه too much load on the heart and on the body. The other risk factors like the GI, the weight gain and the osteopenia are not very commonly encountered. In general, والمهم هو practically speaking, متى بنستخدم هاي الأدوية؟ As second line oral insulin sensitizer. إذا المريض is not tolerating metformin أو المتفورمين is contraindicated, يعني المريض إنه عنده يعني risk of lactic acidosis and we are contraindicating the use of metformin, thiazolidine diones might be a choice. And they can be used in combination with insulin because they increase the sensitivity without affecting the secretion of insulin. لأن المشكلة الوحيدة فيهم هذول in practice إنه they are expensive. تمام؟ ولما تحكي expensive إنه not all patients will benefit or can take advantage of the use of such a drug. لأن we discussed the insulin sensitizer, which have a very important role in the treatment of type 2 diabetics. And عندهم insulin resistant. Then we have another type of drugs that will target increasing the insulin secretion. لما يحكي بأنه they increase the insulin secretion, شو الشرط المهم اللي لازم يكون موجود بالpatient؟ No. Type 2 بس بأي وقت؟ لما يكون لسه عنده شوية بيتا لانجرهانس سيلز. إذا كل البيت ما أنتوا عارفين البانكرياس بعد فترة والبيتا لانجرهانس سيلز بالتايب 2 دايابيتس شو بصير فيها؟ totally digested, ببطل في عنده insulin secretion. فهذولا they will increase insulin secretion only إذا كان type 2 ولسه there is remaining some part of the beta langerhans cell mass inside the pancreas. Then how do they function? It's interesting because it's related to the real physiology of insulin secretion. المفروض تعرفوا بأنه the real physiology is related to the release of insulin from the vacuoles or vesicles اللي موجودين in the body, yeah, in the pancreas. مالك؟ ليه؟ Okay, even the release of these insulin particles from the vacuoles that they are stored in within the pancreas. And how does the body do that? Simply by the activation of the calcium in influx into the cell. لكن المشكلة بأنه at some points إنه the calcium influx is prevented because the potassium is going up and outside the cell through the potassium ATP channel. This is called hyperpolarization. لما يكون في hyperpolarization, شو بيصير بالcalcium channel? They are closed. لأنه الcalcium channel is only open إذا كان في depolarization. لما الcalcium channels are closed, insulin cannot be secreted. طب شو نساوي؟ Simply, this sulfonylurea will come down and bind and inhibit this potassium ATP channel, وبالتالي يمنع ال hyperpolarization, وبالتالي شو بصير depolarization, ونتيجة للdepolarization بصير entry of calcium, ومن ثم عملية ال release of the insulin from the particles within the cell. بتحكي؟ أشوف. Okay. Then the release of insulin from the particles after there is an influx of calcium through depolarization. So this is the mechanism of action of sulfa inhibitors. Now, since they do increase the insulin secretion, they are actually termed as oral insulin secretagogues. لما نحكي insulin secretagogue, it means that they increase the insulin secretion in the body. ولسبب إنها it increases insulin secretion, شو الميجر side effect اللي ممكن يحدث؟ hypoglycemia. This is a hypoglycemic agent. The second thing اللي لازم تعرفوه, إذا الإنسان صار عنده increase the insulin production, وزنه بزيد ولا بقل؟ يزيد طبعا لأنه الإنسولين is anabolic. It increases the body weight and body mass. وبالتالي they are complicated by weight gain, which might not be a preferable thing for diabetic patients. In general, these sulfonylureas are used as either second line therapy for type 2 diabetics إذا كان الميتفورمين is contraindicated or not tolerated. تمام؟ And they can be used as first-line therapy method إذا كان type 2 diabetic patient is underweight. تمام؟ إذا كان thin, a type 2 diabetic patient, we cannot or we don't want to use metformin and we actually prefer to use sulfonylurea. Okay? Then can it be used in combination therapy? Yes. بس مع إيش to be combined? We don't combine it with insulin. We combine it with what? Exactly. مثل الميتفورمين و الثايزوريدين بان. They're not combined with insulin. There's no point. وتذكروا انه متى انا بقدر اعطيهم؟ اذا التايب 2 اصلا diabetic patient لسه عنده pancreatic beta Langerhans cell mass. الان they found that some other sulfonylureas they share the same chemistry and they share the same mechanism of action, but they improved on their onset of action and duration of action. Sulfonylureas, اللي we discussed earlier, are actually drugs that have a long duration of action, but at the same time, a slow onset of action. يعني المريض بده ياخذ الدواء ويستنى فترة ممكن ساعتين لبين ما يبلش the onset of action. Then they found that some of the sulfonylureas, وعشان هيك صار اسمهم sulfonylurea-like drugs, they might have a much shorter duration of action and at the same time a much faster onset of action. طب شو هذا بفيدني؟ إنه عندهم very short duration or short duration of action at the same time a very importantly fast onset of action. That emergency, we don't use oral drugs. Exactly. Some people have something called the postprandial hyperglycemia. يعني their body cannot deal with the glucose that is absorbed into their blood after meal. In such cases, the best choice to use is to use a drug that has a very fast onset of action at the same time, short duration of action. And I did the best to deal with the hyperglycemia that happens after food. In such cases, sulfonylurea-like drugs are one of your choices. It's not indicated in all cases. بكل الأحوال زي ما حكينا إنهم sulfonylurea-like drugs ومعناته they will be complicated by hypoglycemia and weight gain. ولكن هل رح تكون بنفس الدرجة اللي شفناها مع sulfonylureas? Of course not. لأنه إيش the duration of action is much shorter and the onset is much faster. So we don't use them all the time only in cases of postprandial hyperglycemia. Now, in the same topic, in patients, diabetic patients who cannot deal with the level of glucose absorbed after any meal, we have to discuss one drug that's not commonly used, but I finds clinically use something. It's called alpha-glucosidase inhibitor. And if you know the regular metabolism physiology of the intestine, you know that the ingestion of polysaccharides, once it reaches the microvilli within the intestine, and there is an enzyme called the alpha-glucosidase which is responsible for the breakdown of polysaccharides into glucose, and this glucose will be transported or absorbed into the bloodstream. تمام؟ الآن قال أوكي بما أنه هذا الألفا جلوكوسيديز is involved in increasing the level of glucose in blood, شو نساوي؟ Inhibitor. And this is the drug we're talking about. It's called acarbose أو ألفا جلوكوسيديز inhibitor. المهم بأنه هذا الدرج will it be that effective, that great? Of course not. It's not a very effective drug. It's only taken for the postprandial glucose regulation. يعني المريض اللي عنده postprandial hyperglycemia might benefit from that. أما other than that, no. They're not going to benefit from it. وعشان هيك, as a clinical guideline, these drugs cannot be used alone. They're not that effective. إذا فقط المريض عنده مشكلة بالpostprandial hyperglycemia, they might benefit from this drug. لأن لما نحكي بأنه it prevents the absorption of glucose, شو بتتوقع side effects تكون؟ ممكن بس مش too much, لأنه إحنا بنحكي عن something involved in the absorption rather than إنه insulin increase secretion. But actually there's no hypoglycemia. What's more important are the signs and symptoms of what? Of malabsorption. زي اللي خدتوه بالجي آي, malabsorption. The celiac disease and so on. صار عندهم diarrhea, صار عندهم flatulence, ممكن صار عندهم abdominal cramps and so on. إذا أخذوا هذا الدواء prior to means to prevent the postprandial hyperglycemia. المهم إنه تعرف بإنه it's not a great drug. Only use إذا كان المريض عنده postprandial hyperglycemia and I cannot use it alone. Now, the final class of drugs, and then we will wrap up the lecture, are drugs that act on a very important system that is activated in your body right after you eat, or you have orally taken glucose or polysaccharides, carbohydrates. So, this system, and once there is glucose or polysaccharides or carbohydrates reaching into the intestine, there is activation of the secretion of something called incretins. مين اللي بيسوي؟ إذا incretins, وهذول incretins like the GLP-1 أو GIP, glucagon-like peptide and glucagon inhibitory peptide, المهم هذول incretins شو الوظيفة منهم؟ أول ما يصير في عندك uptake or intake of carbohydrates into your GI system. They simply do three things. The first thing and most important thing is to increase the insulin secretion and decrease glucagon. إحنا بدنا أول ما الجسم يتعرض للجلوكوز على طول إنه to increase the insulin secretion. لحتى إنه إيش يصير فيه uptake of glucose from the plasma to the peripheral. At the same time, إنه they induce a state of decreased gastric emptying. لحتى انه ايش تمنع انه كل هالجلوكوز هذا ينزل عن الانتستين ويصير له ابسوربشن. احنا بنقلل من الابسوربشن اوف جلوكوز as much as we can. And most importantly, which is actually working, انه they decrease the appetite. عشان هيك انت بتسمع الناس اللي بتاكل كنافه بقول لك انا ما بقدرش اكل اكثر من صحن او something like that. الريل او النورمال سبجكت صحن يعني. انه اكل صحن and they cannot eat anymore. Why? Because this carbohydrates, once incretins are secreted into your body, they will target the brain and tell it to shut down, احكي لك stop eating. So the appetite is actually reduced after the secretion of these incretins. Then the important thing, you know, they will not continue working all the time. So we have an endogenous system that will break them down after a while. يعني خلاص خلصنا الوجبة, خلصنا, we dealt with carbohydrates. بيجي another enzyme available there and breaks down these incretins. لان إذا أنا بدي أستخدم هذا الحكي بالدايابيتس, what should I use من الفيجر هذا؟ إذا I either use the DPP-4 antagonist to keep incretins working for longer duration of action or to use what? الانكريتنز نفسهم اللي هم بنسميهم incretin mimetics. Incretin mimetics are a new class of drugs that are taking a role in the treatment of diabetes mellitus. The problem is that these drugs have to be injectable. فأنا عشان هيك يعني بقتنعش فيهم ككلاس، إنه أنا بدل ما إنه أعطيه injection of insulin بروح بعطيه injection of the incretin mimetics. What's the point؟ أحسن إشي للtreatment of diabetes what؟ insulin. تاني يعني شو الفائدة؟ إنه بدل ما تعطيه injection of insulin تروح تعطيه injection of incretin mimetics. So it's not that يعني it's not making any sense for me. Particularly because they have to be used twice a day, almost 60 minutes before meal. Then once your body is exposed to carbohydrates, على طول تطلع the incretins and they induce the three changes اللي حكينا عنه. Then what type of hyperglycemia will respond to the use of incretin mimetics? مو أكيد. بس what type? Is it the sustained hyperglycemia ولا postprandial hyperglycemia ولا fasting hyperglycemia? Exactly. هذول إذا بدهم يشتغلوا على أي شيء it's the postprandial hyperglycemia. They're not gonna work on any other thing. Keep in mind هذا ال incretin system بعتقد حكوا لكم بالفيزيولوجي. إذا الإنسان أخذ الجلوكوز IV هل ال incretins بتزيد in their bodies? Exactly. They're only increased فقط in response to oral intake of carbohydrates. And that's why they're considered as one of the choices in the treatment of postprandial hyperglycemia. Okay? الآن, do they reduce weight? Nobody knows. Actually, بس المهم بإنهم they are the last resort. يعني, المريض اللي عنده فوبيا من إنه يتحول لإنسلين نتيجة للإنجكشن وبيخاف من البادي weight gain, بيخاف من الهيبرغلايسيميا, ممكن تحكي له, okay, خلينا نجرب هذا الدرج. بس المشكلة إنه غالي ترى بالدواء. That's not that nice. لأن at the same time producing the same net result ولكن with different mechanism are the drugs that are the DPP-4 antagonists. They will inhibit the enzyme. The good thing about them is that they are orally taken. فبالتالي it's a big advantage over the incretin mimetics. Again the same clinical application. Is here in the postprandial hyperglycemia. They're not going to be effective in any other source of hyperglycemia, and they are your last resort. Again, they are expensive. Will you use them if a patient is afraid of being switched into insulin therapy? تمام. نعم. إحنا خلصنا the drugs, well, the classes of drugs that are used. I want to finish with a few points. And reminders for you about the treatment of diabetes. Then the most important thing to know, and as I mentioned in my first and second lecture, endocrinology is a trial and error discipline. And we don't have fixed guidelines for the treatment of all patients. We have to try something and then see if the body responds or not. And this is a very important concept called the individualization of your treatment. يعني you tailor the treatment according to the type of patient. Not all diabetic patients come from the same pot. Not all diabetic patients have the same color. ممكن حتى المريض اليوم to respond in a certain way, بعد 5 years إنه to respond in another way. So we continuously monitor our patients. We continuously change the regimens according to their needs. To تعرفوا any diabetic patient to monitor the control of the disease شو بنساوي؟ الهيموغلوبين A1C levels. We have to do it every 3 months to check whether the patient is responding well للtreatment ولا لا. تمام؟ فindividualize the treatment. We are talking about the patients themselves, but what about the drugs also? The drugs يا اخوان انا صح شبهت لكم اياهم بانهم عبارة عن اما طيارة ولا سيارة ولا بسكليت. بس مش كل من ركب سيارة صار شمخر ولا كل من لبس بوت صار يوسين بول. وبالتالي my body is responding to the long acting insulin in a much different way than your body is responding to the long acting insulin. كل مريض مفصل على جنب. فبالتالي you have to try something and see what happens later on. After a while you come back and monitor the response to the treatment and decide whether to continue or change. تمام؟ والهبل اللي بصير عندنا للأسف بالأردن إنه مريض السكري أنا بعالجه كيف؟ بجيبه اليوم وبعطيه دواء وبقول له ارجع لي بعد 6-7 أشهر. This does not work. برا ما في حدا بتعامل مع مريض الدايابيتس هيك. لابد من إنه يكون support group زي ما حكينا امبارح وفيها different disciplines ولازم تشوف المريض ممكن كل شهر. تمام، ما بصير انه تتركه 6 اشهر بعدين تيجي تقول له تعال ممكن نغير الجرعه نسوي. This does not work. لان the other thing انه حتى انتم بتعرفوا من خلال اللكتشر what I mentioned today انه if I have a type 2 diabetic that looks like this, it's not the same as a type 2 diabetic that looks like this. In this patient, what type of oral antidiabetic agent should you start with?
Metformin.
بينما in this, it has to be sulfonylurea. So it depends on also the patient's factors, how their bodies are shaped, or the weight of that body. والأهم من ذلك إنه there are different types of hyperglycemia. مش كل diabetic patients عندهم the same type of hyperglycemia. Let's not forget the three types I'm worried about, اللي هم من fasting والpostprandial والsustain. هذول sustain دراي. sustain خلاص أعطيهم metformin, sulfonylurea it works أو حولهم على insulin. بس مشكلتك هون. إذا المريض regularly عنده good glucose control، لكن إذا أكل أي وجبة مباشرة يصير عنده bad control postprandial. In such cases مش ما أقدر أستخدم metformin as my first choice. I have to look for other choices that target the postprandial hyperglycemia. هلا رح أورجيكم اياهم. Now another thing, إنه يا إخوان ال American Diabetes Association, the most recent guidelines. صح إحنا we monitor the response to treatment through measuring the HbA1c. ويجي نحكي لك زي ما كان زمان خلاص 7 أو 6. This does not work anymore. Diabetes is a public health problem. It's a psychosocial problem. Will patients they continue to have diabetes and suffer from diabetes related depression for يعني tens of years. So you cannot deal with them انه كلياتهم نفس المبدا بدك تيجي تقرفه وتحكي له بدك ما تاكلش هيك وما تسويش هيك بدك تلعب رياضه وبدك تعمل كذا وال HbA1c لازم يكون يا اخي ما بزبطش. You're dealing with a human being rather than a machine. عشان هيك شو وجدت الامريكان دايبيتس اسوشيشن حكى اذا كان عندك motivated patient تمام وما عندوش comorbidities لساته young وعنده motivation ونيولي diagnosed اوكي هذا الزلمه باجي بمسكه وبقول له بدك تلتزم مزبوط وتخلي ال HbA1c تبعك اقل من 7. Very strict with them. بس بالله عليك ما تتعاملوا مع حجه كبيره عمرها 60-70 سنه and she is obese and she is with the diabetes for more than 30 years. She cannot eat well, she cannot respond to any kind of treatment, she is switched to insulin, will insulin fee injection وفي weight gain وبنفس الوقت في risk of hypoglycemia وتيجي انه والله بدي اياه 7 اذا مش 7 بصير صيح المريض. I saw it. Yeah, this is not well. You cannot be very strict with these patients. You have to be more flexible, more lenient, ودخل the nutritionist ودخل the psychiatrist in the treatment of such patients. لأن as a reminder احنا حكينا عن 3 types of drugs اللي هم secretagogues والsensitizers والpostprandial regulators. Just a reminder انه هذول هم sulfonylureas والsulfonylurea like drugs. Sensitizers هم bigonines with TZDs. بينما postprandial regulators اللي هم acarbose اللي هو alpha glucosidase inhibitor و incretin mimetics and also DPP-4 antagonists. Now, let's not forget that هذول drugs هم the only ones that might be complicated with hypoglycemia. The others are not. Now, just a reminder of the major side effects and characteristics of these drugs. عندك sulfonylureas, they are complicated for hypoglycemia. This is from your lipid code. الالفا جلوكوسيدايز انهبيترز والبايجونايز عندهم تو ماتش جاستروانتستينال ديستربنس. ليتس نوت فورجيت اولسو اباوت ذا فازوليدين دايونز اند ذا كارديوفاسكولار ريسك. اي ويل فينيش ذس ليكتشر باي ريمايندينج يو اوف وات وي ستارتد وذ امبارح ما لحقتوش تنسوا. يعني دايابيتس از ا كرونيك اند بروجريسيف كونديشن. حتى لو بلشت هون يو ويل اند اب هون. تمام. Is it worth it? Yes, it is worth it because we will slow the progression and reduce and limit the chronic complication. In the early stages, they might benefit from dieting and exercise. Second phases, they might benefit from single drug therapy. At one point, it does not work. لازم تعطي metformin وsulfonylurea combination therapy. وبعدين شاء أم أبا رح يتحول على الانسولين وممكن الانسولين انه to be combined with other oral drugs like for example الانسولين sensitizer. Okay, you have a question. Yes. Good point. Now, recommendation and what depends on the age of the patient. What risk factors are to shorten? If a patient is young, they might respond well to diet and exercise. There is actually no need to start them on drugs. إلا إذا إنه جاك هو يعني أكبر شوي, he's not motivated, ومش عارف إيش هذا, حتى لو كان pre-diabetic, you have to start them on metformin. It's your first line oral anti-diabetic agent. تمام؟ Any other questions? Yes.
هلا لو عندنا
patient
أحد وزد إلى أخذ حبة metformin,
عشان هيك it's actually not. عشان هيك the oral anti-diabetic agents are not your best choice for the treatment of diabetes. Diabetes, the best choice is to replace what's missing. اللي هو الإنسولين. هاي اللي أكل وجبة ثقيلة وبقدر يأخذ يغير الجرعة وكذا مع الإنسولين. مع the oral anti-diabetic agents not to. And you have to give the drug, مثلاً twice a day, for example, أو الميتفورمين we can give it three times a day, maximum dose. أكل وجبة ثقيلة, أكل وجبة خفيفة, هو حر. فهي cannot do anything more. لكن مع الإنسولين, no. إنسولين والله أنت أكلت وجبة اليوم أكبر فيها كربوهيدراتس أكثر, ممكن تستخدم جرعة أعلى. و things be good. It's not very bad. بإيش؟ yes, طبعا. regular dose. مش يعني خلاص إنه والله اليوم أكل ولا no. regular dose. كثير من المرضى بعد فترة ما بزبطش الميتفورمين alone, we have to add sulfonylurea, تمام؟ وبعديها فترة ما بزبطش, we have to switch to insulin therapy. Okay? Yes.
الزيت
T2
inhibitor.
Yes.
هل ممكن يجي
مش خدتوها كيف؟ okay. Yeah. The SGLT2 inhibitors are not, they're not used currently. There is only two or three drugs that are approved. We'll set them with how should America or the European know which one is better, which one to be distributed. فنو. أنا بحب درس الإشي اللي موجود. بعد 5 سنين ممكن to be approved. But I will start teaching you. It's not that good. كل أحوالي. طيب. Now, the topic that I had left from yesterday's lecture أو اللي قبلها اللي هم الكالسيمايماتكس, and I like to present this topic because it's very interesting to see how people think and how they developed a genius idea for the treatment of one particular condition related to bone mineralization. لأن in general يا أخوان تعرفوا بأنه الثيرويد follicular cell is the one responsible for the secretion of the parathyroid hormone, صح؟ In response to what? متى تفرز ال parathyroid hormone? Exactly. لما الكالسيوم is not available هون. فيها ال parathyroid gland, فيها calcium sensing receptor. إذا ما فيش كالسيوم, it will respond by increasing the parathyroid hormone لحتى to go into the intestine والكدني والبون to increase the calcium levels, صح؟ طيب. الآن إذا كان في calcium around, على طول الكالسيوم will come down and bind to the receptor and that will prevent the secretion of parathyroid hormone. الآن imagine the following. إذا كان هذا الريسبتر responds مثلا إذا كانت ال level of calcium in the surrounding area كانت مثلا for example 1 milligram. إجينا وأعطينا لهذا الريسبتر something called an energy drink. بدل ما إنه كان الريسبتر responds to levels around 1 milligram, شو بصير؟ It might respond to levels even lower than that. وهذا اسمه الكالسيمايماتيك. It means that it comes down and it's like an energy boost to activate the calcium sensing receptor حتى على levels of calcium that are very low. عشان هيك they don't compete with calcium on the binding. They bind to a different place. In addition to that, they're not going to activate the receptor in the absence of calcium. لازم يكون شوية كالسيوم موجود يرتبط بالريسبتر وبالتالي they activate the process of prevent the secretion of parathyroid. طيب حكونا مين عبقري حكينا انه وين نستخدم الحق يعني شو نستفيد من الحق which type of hack
secondary
مين حكي which type of secondary hyperparathyroidism يعني what is the most common cause of secondary hyperparathyroidism chronic kidney disease يا اخوي احنا مشكلتنا مش يعني parathyroid is functioning normal بس المشكله بانه الكالسيوم in the body is being excreted is being reduced وبالتالي the body responds by more and more and more parathyroid hormone secretion so this will complicate issues فعشان يصير عندك secondary hyperparathyroidism due to chronic renal disease طب شو نسوي كيف بدنا نضحك على الثايرويد gland to prevent the secretion of parathyroid hormone زي ما حكينا انه activate the receptor even على much lower levels of calcium concentrations in the surrounding يعني اللي اخترع هذا الاختراع عن جد عبقري انه هو ما اشتغل على الكالسيوم وانما اشتغل على انه to activate to sensitize the receptor even more to prevent the secretion of the parathyroid hormone as a secondary problem to chronic kidney disease this is one use what other use could be taken care of by calcium ion ما نطري يعني مشكلتنا لا انه عندنا باد كالسيوم او عندنا باد باراثيرويد الباراثيرويد كارسينوما باراثيرويد كارسينوما احنا مش ناقصنا مور اند مور سيكريشن اوف باراثيرويد هرمون يعني انت في عندك انكنترولبل جروث اوف ذا باراثيرويد فوليكولار سيل وكلها بدها تعمل سيكريشن اوف ذا باراثيرويد هرمون فبيزيد الليفر بشكل عالي جدا مما يؤدي الى انه ايش يصير عند البيشنت اوستيوبوروسيس ليتر فتو تريت ذا يو جيف the sinacalcet or calcium mimetics to increase the sensitivity of the receptor to calcium وبالتالي to prevent more and more secretion of the parathyroid hormone. There are a great class of drugs that are used orally. The interesting thing in one of the drugs that will rapidly reduce the level of parathyroid hormone مباشرة بعد ما تعطيه. تمام؟ يعني خلال يوم أو يومين تلاقي levels of parathyroid hormone بدل ما كانت هون بلشت تنزل بشكل سريع تمام and they have also a long half life which reaches up to 30 to 40 hours تمام وبالتالي you are very comfortable giving it to the patient and the patient will not complain on top of that they don't have too many side effects they actually well tolerated only just a simple nausea and vomiting then this drug انا again انه بصراحه مش عارف انه very frequently used هون ولا لا بس برا موجود المهم انه الايديا انه how to go around the problem and come up with an intelligent idea to deal with the problem so in the cases of secondary hyperparathyroidism due to chronic renal disease this is one of the best choices in the treatment اسمهم calcium mimetics تمام ما قعدتش شكرا خمس دقايق طيب مصطفى شكرا اوكي في اسئله otherwise merry christmas للاخوان المسيحيين نشوفكم ان شاء الله الاسبوع الجاي يوم الثلاثاء